The book is about how the French remember Anzac, or rather how they don't, and how they remember in this stage by official Australian organisations. It looks at Australian commemorations in northern France from 1918 to today, and how Australian organisations have tried to assemble, project and perform Australian national identity overseas. The gap that there is between the way Australian official institutions commemorate Anzac and the way everyday Australians commemorate Anzac. So the simplified, glorified, jingoistic narrative of the Department of Veterans Affairs is not necessarily the way everyday Australians who go to the Western Front, who go to these graves, speak of the First World War. So the way some Australians interact with these graves is quite profound. It is meaningful to them. It goes beyond the commemoration of Anzac and the national narrative. It is something that is personal. So when you look at the visitors' books in the cemeteries of the First World War and what Australians write in there, you've got a wide array of ways in which Australians remember the First World War. And it's often not about pride. It's about commemorating someone who actually died there. One thing that Australians would be surprised to learn about, and which I document in this book, is that Australia as a nation is the country that spent the most money on the commemoration of the centenary of the First World War. More than any other nation put together. Gallipoli and the Western Front feature very prominently in Australia's national narrative. Yet if you go overseas, people don't necessarily know of this involvement. And lately, the Australian government has developed a 100 million John Monash Centre at Villa Bretonneau to tell the Australian story of the Great War. Now, that centre sits a bit at odds with other museums and centres like that on the Western Front who emphasise the sorrow, the sacrifice, the hardship. Whether the Sir John Monash Centre, which is discussed in the book, it's more about making Australians proud. Often you see French diplomatic personnel reminding of the Anzac story when they promote French agenda, such as the sale of French submarines to Australia. So when that sale was going on, every commemorative gesture that the French could do, they did. They sent ministers at Villa Bretonneau, which they hadn't done since the unveiling in 1938. If there is one thing I'd like people to remember about the book, there are perhaps a couple of things. One, I think, is that people need to develop an awareness of the way politicians, left or right, have used Anzac to serve their own interest and separate the political story from the actual experience that these soldiers went through. And I think the second point is that there is a need to internationalize Australian military history. You can't write Australian history with only Australian archives or British archives. What this book does is that half of its data, half of its archives is actually in French and from France. Archives that consider Australian history from a different perspective. And hopefully that can enrich the way we think about Anzac and the way we think about Australian commemorations.